Coach, I know some of your former players, when you were at your former stop, have really complimented you at the next level and talked about how what you meant to them trying to get to that point. Do you ever have any of those guys come back and talk to some of your Arkansas players about trying to reach that next level and take the program forward?
You know, I made first, I appreciate that and what you said, but I made a pretty conscientious decision. I knew that the outside world was going to do enough comparisons from my transition from Wisconsin to Arkansas that I didn't want to throw it in my players' faces. You know, this. I wanted to build Arkansas. And over the course of time, they would ask a lot of questions. You know, you have two of the premier players in the league, Russell Wilson and J.J. Watt. They figured out who they played for, and that brought a lot of certain questions around. So I didn't really force it. First off, it's illegal to have them recruit for you. I know some people do that, but we don't. So I couldn't really arrange anything like that, but it was kind of just a heartfelt thing happened this week. Kiro Small, for those that know Kiro from a year ago, is my fullback and kind of a heartbeat guy. He was a kid that was recruited maybe as a linebacker, fullback, broke his leg going into what he thought was going to be his senior year, ended up coming back and having a year with me when we truly used a fullback, and I think really made a difference in the kid's life. I mean, he was probably a kid that wouldn't have been where he is today if the whole staff, you know, just a different style. So he's a fullback that gets drafted and goes to the Seattle Seahawks. I had a feeling that was going to happen. They were very, I don't know, John Schneider, the GM there, as soon as it happened, Russell shot me a text, and then I texted Kiro, and then I shot each other their contact information and let them begin the conversation. And then Kiro came in my office on Monday, in their early Monday morning. He came walking in, and he had been in his OTAs, you know, with the Seahawks. And I said, "My man, Russell taking care of you." And he's like, "Coach," he goes, "the detail," and he talked about how Russell would, you know, throw a pass, but then he would continue and simulate like he was throwing the pass three more times, and you had to be expecting it, and you had to simulate the catch and act like you had caught it, because he wanted to take through the progression on every play, not just every other, not just certain, every play of practice. And it's why he had success. But now Kiro, now I think, has come back and told that story I don't know how many times to our current roster, and that has an effect. You know, I'll probably use references more and more as we go through it, but I want to start having some Arkansas players to reference that, and we have some good ones. We have some guys that are getting their chance now in the NFL, and hopefully they're more prepared because we had a chance to coach them. Yes?
How you doing, Coach? Earlier today, Coach Pinkel had said that he thinks the idea that fiction. How do you feel about that? And about the just 10-second rule in general?
Well, you know, I'm sure that that quote is being used in a certain light. You know, I'm not a guy that's against fast play. I obviously don't use it. I think the thing that gets lost, I just was in another interview and they're like, "Coach, you're a proponent you've been very outspoken on pace of play." Well, in reality, I haven't. What I've been outspoken on is player safety. That's what I believe in. However it comes about, I don't care. I want the ability to be able to substitute every side of the every phase of the game equally. That's it. I think the reason that the offensive coaches react in such a strong way when they talk about the 10-second rule is there's an obvious advantage that's being capitalized on. If you don't see that, you're oblivious to reality. As far as Coach Pinkel, if he loves fiction, I love reality. I love Star Wars and all the other fiction movies I've ever seen, but I'm kind of a John Wayne fan, you know, so I like reality-based movies, and the same comes in real life.
Brett, you walked into a locker room that was kind of marred by instability with all the coaching turnover. Now you're going into year two, have some stability. What have you seen from your team now in terms of building up trust and things like that?
That is an absolutely great comment. I think the word instability kind of sums it up in a nice way, just that kids had a lot of transition. They'd had a lot of different coaches. One of the biggest challenges I began to figure out after I was there was I had a room full of kids that maybe had lost that care factor. They had lost the ability to care for themselves first and foremost. Guys were settling for a C in the classroom or a D when they could get a B or an A. Kids were settling for making behaviors and social choices away from the game that maybe weren't making great choices for them in life, you know. So I needed to get those kids to care about themselves first. I needed to let them know that I cared about them, the coaches I hired cared about them, that we cared about them. And then all of a sudden they start caring about themselves, and then you got a better chance that they actually might care about the guy next to them. And it becomes a contagious effect. It was a very, very difficult year, but it's one that I'm glad I was a part of. It helped my DNA. It helped me become a man that I am today. And the thing about year two is just the way to expand upon that or measure it or tell you what that's worth, you can't even put a finger on it. This team is so different from a year ago, and not that we didn't have great people and great camp. We didn't have enough of what we need, and now we got a lot of what we need, and we're going to have to start showing in the win column to make that happen.
Hey, Coach, forgetting for a moment that he's your boss, if it was up to you,
the chair?
If it was up to you, how many, would there be more than four teams in the playoff?
My boss, we call him the chair, because he is the chair of the big committee. I think that the world of college football has been crying for a playoff, and rightfully so. We got a game that is unbelievable, and you'd hate to have it come down to two teams selected, you know, with a lot of debate. It's going to go to four, and I'm sure teams five and six are going to be upset, or the teams that think they should have been one through four. But it's a good starting point, you know. Rome wasn't built in a day, and you know it takes a while to get to where you want to be. And I think the fact that we have a four-team playoff, we have a committee chair that is absolutely phenomenal in the world of college football, and not just him. You know, my old boss, Coach Alvarez, who, despite how everything fell apart there during my transition, I think the world of. He's an incredible mind, an incredible person to have him on a committee. Condoleezza Rice. I know there is varying points of view on when she was named to be a part of it. She came and spoke on campus. We have a lecture series, and I mandated my whole team go and hear her speak. And to hear 120 men rave about the opportunity they had to hear Condoleezza Rice speak was unbelievable. And I knew it because I've heard her talk. I've read what she's written, and I wanted our kids to understand what was going on. Plus, you know, if she has to vote for us someday, I want her to know we had 120 hogs sitting in the crowd. I'm no stupid person. It's in my first rodeo. But I think the fact that there is such a wealth of knowledge on that committee it makes it very, very exciting to be a part of it.
Coach, over here to the left, what has been the biggest difference or learning curve coming over to the SEC in coaching?
You know, I think that's, you know, an obvious question was obviously we went 3-9. I had a lot of success in the Big Ten. It's learning the style of play. I do think there are certain things that I observed during the course of the year that are just very apparent, and I don't mean any disrespect to one league versus the other. I'm in the SEC. Just a simple thing. I think you can play a lot more aggressively in this league defensively. I think you can play with your hands on people on offense a little bit more, too, in the offensive line play. I think that was something that I had to learn as a coach, and coaches need to observe that. The obvious things to me is depth is paramount. Not just depth for a season, but depth for a game. To play a four-quarter game, there are a lot of things that we did well in the first and second quarter that we couldn't execute in the third and fourth quarter. Case in point, LSU, a chance to win our last ball game. We run a play against a formation that we executed perfectly against earlier in the ball game, but with 2 minutes left in the game, we broke mentally and physically the coverage. So you got to believe that maybe if you had added depth there, that player wasn't maybe physically and emotionally drained, better results would happen. But on the same account, not making excuses, the number one thing we have to learn to overcome is we need to play better in adversity. You know, I say it all the time, a man is truly introduced to himself when he reacts to adversity. You know, everybody does well when you're doing things right and you're winning and all that jazz, but when you hit a bump in the road, when you got a little adversity, when somebody punches you in the face, how you respond, it truly defines who you are.
Coach, to your left over here,
yeah.
For two players in particular, what have you seen from Alan Turner this offseason and true freshman Bijan Jackson?
Alan can tie a bow tie. I'm sure you guys have already seen that. Kind of pissed they left me out of the bow tie committee. The three guys all world class. I said, well, where's the love? I guess they thought I wasn't a bow tie guy. But Alan last year was our leading tackler. You never liked that, like I said, in a big room as a safety. But it does tell me he's got an incredible nose for the football. Alan Turner got better in every game, which tells me you got a kid that wants to learn. There was a time where he he butted up Robert Thomas, who probably weighs almost 150 pounds more than him, is a lot stronger and physically more imposing, but he was ready to throw down with him just because there was a difference of an opinion, and I respect that. So I think he's got a great year in front of him, and the other one is Bijan. Bijan is built like a defensive lineman. He's got an incredible ass, really big in size, and in defensive line play, that's good. You really he's going to be an immovable object that I think we get excited about. He's got hot feet. He's been raised by an incredible set of parents. His high school coach, I think, didn't want to see him go, but he can probably conduct a good high school practice just because he was such a dominant player. It was very hard for them to get looks. I think the part that excites me about anything is I think he came in and in the first 2 weeks we needed to lose weight. I believe he lost 14 pounds in 8 days, and that doesn't happen. Believe me, as a guy that needs to lose weight, I get it. And he's a guy that knew he needed to do it, and he just put his mind to it, and I think he's going to be a guy that should help us right away. Thank you.